positive case and that you'll pause?
It's not clear. It would depend on the circumstances. Of course, when we paused in mid-March, we knew very little about COVID-19, about this particular coronavirus. And we were also at that time had fans in our arenas, and we weren't really doing any large scale testing of our players. We were only testing the particular player, Rudy Gobert, who tested positive on the Utah Jazz. He was tested because he had symptoms. And then we did some additional testing of those people, of course, who had been around him. Now we're in a very different environment. There are no fans whatsoever. We're testing on a daily basis. We're following those other protocols. So if we were to get a single positive test, it probably wouldn't shut us down. But what we'd want to do is try to understand through tracing how that person, whether it be a player, a coach, or someone else who's on that campus, got the virus.
How many positive cases do you think it would take for, let's say, all the teams, all the NBA teams who are playing down in Florida to pause the season again?
Well, if we had any significant spread whatsoever, we would certainly stop immediately. And then we would investigate and determine whether we could move forward. I mean, I'm watching, obviously, what's happening in baseball right now. They have a group of infections on one particular team. They've paused that team. And as far as I understand it, they intend to continue on with their season. I'm sure they're undergoing the same analysis we would and try to figure out where the spread is coming from and whether their protocols are working.
Have you had conversations with the other major sports commissioners, for example, Major League Baseball, to get lessons from them, lessons from you? Baseball, Major League Baseball right now seems to be in huge trouble. They're not playing in a bubble like you guys are.
We do all talk, but I would only say the circumstances are very different. Again, our system, our season was suspended. You know, we had already played 80% of our regular season. So in essence, putting our players in a bubble environment required sort of a different set of sacrifices than it would to play an entire baseball season, or for that matter, an entire NFL season. Plus, obviously, outdoors, indoors, different numbers of participants. So we talk, but we all have very different situations.
I assume you would cancel the NBA season, Adam, if that was the right, that would be the right thing to do, if it involved the players' health and safety and other personnel, coaches, et cetera. You would just end the season, right?
No question. In fact, that's what we did on March 11th. We, as you said earlier, we had a single positive case and we stopped the season that night. And so we haven't been playing, you know, for roughly 4 months. So it's a different standard now because, again, we have a different protocol in place. But everything we've done has been in partnership with our Players Association. And you know, we have a panel of experts, immunologists, infectious disease experts, public health experts. And really, they would make the decision, frankly. It would not be a business decision.
Tell us a little bit, and I want to move on to some other issues, but tell us a little bit about the testing protocols, the other measures that are in place in the bubble in Florida right now.
In essence, everyone is tested on a nightly basis, and then they, as a practical matter, don't leave their room until they have the results the next morning. So it varies a little bit, but roughly it's around a 10, 12-hour turnaround. We're also experimenting with some point-of-care testing. You know, it's one of the things our experts are working with down there, and that is to increase the amount of tests available. Just not only in this community, but nationally, there's a bunch of now new companies that have, in essence, 20-minute tests that don't need to go to a lab, are all self-contained. And so in addition to the PCR overnight test, the traditional ones which require swabbing, in our case, of nose and throat, we also have these other tests that we're just introducing now. We can use those if we get a positive test to quickly check others. We can use those for visitors who come in onto our campus but don't have access to the players, maybe just at a single point in the arena. So that's the type of testing we're undergoing. But we're rigorous about our other protocols. Everyone, other than when guys have to take those masks off when they're playing basketball, masks are required at all times on the campus. And we keep people physically distant in any way we can possible in terms of when eating arrangements, outdoor activities. It's all the things that the doctors on your network are constantly recommending.
What sort of consequences will there be? And you know there will be these certain players. What will they face if they sneak out of the so-called bubble or break the rules that you have in place, which are very strict rules?
It, It would be tough to sneak out given this campus environment. And so, but we have had players who have left, and there is a protocol for when they leave in terms of how they can reenter. And it requires not only testing when they're off campus, but multi-days of quarantine when they return to campus. And that's something we've dealt with a few particular cases. I mean, remember, putting aside sneaking off, we haven't dealt with that. But of course, these are real live people who have families and, you know, crises and issues within their families that need to be taken care of. You know, there's several hundred players on the campus. So we anticipated if this campus setup works, the finals won't end until October 13th. So it requires, I mean, in fairness to everybody, enormous sacrifice being away from their families, being in one place. I mean, there's a lot of course, wonderful benefits that come with being an NBA player, but it's difficult in everybody's lives, all the things that around social justice that are happening around the communities in our country. So we recognize that there may be times when they have to leave, but it's health and safety first. So whatever the reason is, we still have to follow a certain protocol to bring them back.
We all remember at the start of this, Rudy Gobert of the Utah Jazz, he made light of the virus. And now you have Denver Nuggets forward Michael Porter Jr. saying the pandemic, in his word, is overblown, being used to, quote, control the masses. Does that attitude potentially endanger him and his teammates?
It's unfortunate that he said that. I would only say in our league, we have 450 players. Guys are young, occasionally going to say silly things. I think most people quickly dismiss that comment.
This season will be very different for those of us who are huge NBA fans, and I admit I am one of them. What will it be like watching these games on TV without fans in the stadium?
We've had a few scrimmage games so far, so we have a sense of it. I mean, it's a very different experience. It's obviously very different for the players, and it's different for the fans watching at home. I mean, in this sport, like a lot of others, you know, there's that home court advantage, that six man, it's sort of the roar of the crowd, the boos of the crowd. I mean, we're trying to replicate that to a certain extent without just like piping in obvious crowd noise. We have a partnership with Microsoft. They have a product called Teams with this together mode where you actually have fans up on arena screens on the sidelines who are at home and watching with their friends and others and talking about the game. So, and you can see their images courtside. There's an app that literally as part of the NBA app where you can tap to cheer. We're adding all kinds of new camera angles because, of course, we don't have people in the seats. So we don't have to find new, you know, we could put cameras in places we typically couldn't. We have a rail cam that goes back and forth. We have unique audio we haven't had in the past. So we're trying to do our best to replicate that, the experience that fans are used to at home, but also to create excitement in the arena for the players.
If you're speaking to me, Adam, from New York, are you planning to go to Orlando to go into that bubble, stay in that bubble for these games over these next few months?
I'm heading down to Orlando tomorrow. I'm going to be at the games on Thursday and Friday night, which is our opening on TNT tomorrow night and ESPN on Friday. Then I'm going to travel back and forth a bit, and then I'm going to move down onto the campus later on in the summer. And just so it's clear, there's a protocol. I've been tested. I'll be tested again before I enter the campus in Orlando. But even having been tested, there we have different tiers. I'll be a so-called tier four entrant. I'll be able to go directly to the arena, sit in essence, they're small arenas, but the upper deck of the arena, physically distant from everyone else, obviously far away from our players, and that's a protocol in which I can enter to watch a game. But then later on, towards the end of the summer, I will move down there, quarantine, and then be part of the campus life.
This renewed season, Adam, as you well know, and all of our viewers know, comes with a renewed commitment by many of the NBA players to the cause of racial justice in our country. How do you see the NBA's role and your role as commissioner when it comes to supporting those players? What will you do, for example, if some of those players decide to kneel during the national anthem?
As you know, Wolf, the league has a long history of you know, supporting important issues around social justice. It's no secret that 80% of our players are Black. I think that, you know, around the death of George Floyd, many of our players were seen protesting. Many have been extraordinarily active in their communities on social media. And when we came together to put this protocol in place for returning to play, they made it very clear how important it was to them that just because they were going to be, in essence, isolated down in Orlando, they still wanted to be actively participating in this movement. So you're going to see down on our floor, it does says Black Lives Matter right on the arena floor. Players, something they worked out with their Players Association, have selected certain messages around social justice to wear on their jerseys. So, and in addition, we're in discussions with our Players Association about creating a foundation, something that all 30 teams would be part of, dedicated to economic empowerment, specifically focused on the Black community in the United States.
So, but if a player does kneel during the national anthem, what happens?
We've had a rule in place for a long time that requires players to stand. It precedes my predecessor, David Stern. I will say, though, I do respect a peaceful protest, and you know we'll see what happens if that's the case. But I understand this is a unique moment in our history.